Okay. Okay, good evening to everybody, to the Greek students, to the Bulgarian students, and the Czech students. My name, as Jordanka said, is Ioannis Tsiripidis, and I'm working as Associate Professor in the School of Biology in the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Actually, I'm a vegetation scientist, and I'm dealing with forest ecology, forest vegetation, also with the geography and the ecology of plant species and the conservation of plant diversity. This is the second slide. As I said before, biodiversity is represents the variety and variability among living organisms, as well as the ecological complexes in which they occur. And I said that they can distinguish in organized in four levels: the genetic, population, community, and landscape. And each level represents different aspects of diversity. So, one important question is how we can measure biodiversity. In order to conserve biodiversity, of course, we must find a way to measure it. There are many biodiversity indicators developed since many years now, but the use of a certain measure of biodiversity quantification, it depends on the purpose of such a measure. Specifically, if our purpose is to investigate the biodiversity patterns in time and space, as well as its response on certain measures and threats, then we shall use a specific, a certain biodiversity indicator. We need, in this instance, a measurable indicator so as to assess the status of biodiversity. In general, there are two categories of biodiversity indicators. The first category is species range that reflects the number of species present in an area. And the second category is species abundance distribution that measures the probability distribution of population sizes of the species in an area. Another important classification of diversity indices is the compositional diversity, the functional diversity, and the phylogenetic diversity. As it's clear from the names of these attributes of diversity, the compositional diversity represents the diversity in taxa in an area. The functional diversity represents the diversity in traits, in functional traits and functional groups of organisms in an area, while the phylogenetic diversity represents the phylogenetic differences between the species in an area. Nowadays, especially in research, it is widely accepted that we should study all these aspects of diversity in order to investigate and interpret the biodiversity patterns in an area, and in order to conserve in the best possible way these patterns. However, a major disadvantage of the biodiversity indicators is that they lose a specific important information, and this information concerns the identity of organisms. Specifically, a biodiversity indicator does not give the information about the difference in species composition or in traits composition between areas. On the other hand, if we want to measure biodiversity in order to conserve biodiversity, what we need is actually a map of species occurring in an area. We need also, besides the map, also data about the population of these species. So we need this data, this map, for the area under conservation. And I will use in this presentation as an example the county of Chalkidiki. This is the county of Chalkidiki in the northeast part of Greece. So we need this map, and then we need the distribution of species in this area. So here we have seven species, and we need the map of this species distribution. But we also need information about the distribution and the populations of these species for a wider area. So if we want to conserve the biodiversity in Chalkidiki area. We need also the distribution data about these species in a wider area, such as Greece, or ideally for the whole distribution area of the species, for instance, the Balkans, the Europe, etc. Now, as I said before, biodiversity is, includes everything. So it is very difficult to measure everything. Specifically, we would like to measure, to see which organisms are present in an area. Not as a big area, small area, such as an area of 100 of hectares. We need months of work for many scientists in order to record any organism that occur in this area. So, what we can do for such situation is to use biodiversity surrogates. What is a biodiversity surrogate? It's something, an element of biodiversity that represents also other elements of biodiversity. For instance, a biodiversity surrogate can be butterflies. And it is surrogate because we suppose that, we hypothesize that if we conserve butterflies, we will also conserve plants. Another surrogate can be habitat types. And our hypothesis is that protecting and conserving habitat types will also conserve mammals or birds. Some of the most used surrogates are species composition, what I said before, butterflies, plants, bryophytes, mammals, birds. Another type of surrogate is species assemblages, that is species communities. Another type of biodiversity surrogate is vegetation classes. We can use also environmental parameters as biodiversity surrogate because we suppose that protecting a variety of environmental conditions, we will also protect a variety of organisms in an area. And finally, we can use as surrogate higher taxa as genera of a category of organisms. Another important issue in biodiversity conservation is the establishment of conservation areas and network. The task of conserving biodiversity actually requires the prioritization of places for conservation actions. The conservation areas are geographically defined areas recognized, dedicated, and managed through legal or other effective means in order to achieve the long-term conservation of nature with associated ecosystem services and cultural values. The conservation areas and networks have a central role in conservation in general. The concern about the extinction of species arose in the 19th century and resulting in the protected area theory during the 20th century. The establishment of conservation networks is one of the most important measures we take in order to protect biodiversity. It is supposed that outside conservation areas, our main purpose is to exploit nature, but inside the conservation networks, we aim mainly at the conservation of nature. So, the importance of the networks, conservation networks establishment is proved by the very high increase of the number, which is shown by this line, and the area, which is shown by this surface, of conservation areas around the world during the last 4 to 5 decades. So, a major question that exists in conservation planning is how we can choose these areas to maximize the biodiversity conservation. This selection procedure has evolved during the decades from simple rationale to very complex and effective algorithms. In the past, and especially until the decade of 80s, and before, a very common way for the selection of conservation areas was the use of criteria. Specifically, in initial approaches to systematic conservation planning or using certain criteria in a single scoring ranking systems. These are the most commonly used criteria in these scoring ranking systems, and among them, the most usually used is diversity, rarity, and naturalness. Let's see how these criteria were applied in order to select areas for conservation networks. Diversity is simply the number of species in an area, and in order to apply this criterion, we just have to measure the number of species for each category of organisms we want in an area. There are some considerations about the use of diversity, and this concerns the difficulty in estimation of the true number of species, because the estimation of diversity is very much dependent on sampling effort. Another problem is that the richness of species in an area depends on ecosystem stability against disturbances. So it expresses actually in a way how stable is an ecosystem against disturbances. Another problem is that diversity does not give us information about species identities, it's just numbers. The rarity, on the other hand, is a very common used criterion, and it is has more or less a moral character. Rarity nowadays has been not used very often, and it is replaced by the extinction possibilities, because there are very different reasons for rarity. A species may be rare just because it is an endemic species, or it can be rare because it faces a lot of threats and it is nearly extinct. And another problem with the use of rarity is that rarity strongly depends on scale. We have local rarity, we have regional rarity, and we have world rarity. Finally, the naturalness just comprises a metric of the degree of human-induced impact on natural ecosystems. It is usually estimated subjectively, and it is a qualitative criterion, not a quantitative criterion. And it has a problem that it gives more weight to final stages of succession. A forest, for instance, is more natural than a grassland under the timber line. So forest takes a higher rank according to the criterion of naturalness, but the grassland may be more important for the conservation of biodiversity. Let's see how these criteria were used in the selection of conservation areas. This is also, again, the area of Chalkidiki, and these are the distribution of species we want to protect in Chalkidiki. So we have four candidate areas for conservation, and a dogma that occurs in conservation is that we cannot conserve everything. We cannot select all the candidate areas for conservation purposes because there are conflicts with other land uses. So at most we can select the 50% of the candidate areas. And in real world examples, this percentage is up to 20 or at most 30%. So here in our example, we will select half of the areas, that is two areas. Now, if we use as criterion the diversity, we must calculate the number of species of each area. These are the number of species. And then according to this solely criterion, we must select the first peninsula of Chalkidiki that hosts six species, and then the second peninsula that hosts five species, and reject the other two areas. If you use the combination of criteria, diversity and rarity, in such a case also we will select two areas for conservation purposes, and we have to make, because we use two criteria, a scoring system. First, we relativize the area's richness by dividing by the maximum richness. So we have this richness in these areas. The maximum richness is 6 species. So we'll divide the richness of each area by the maximum value, which is 6. And we get these indices, 0.5, 1, 0.83, for the criterion diversity. Then we must make a similar index for rarity. Let's make this index by dividing the maximum frequency of species, which is 3, and then add the ratios per locality and divide the sums by the richness of each area. These calculations are made in these boxes. So for this area, we have to divide the frequency of the fourth species, which is 3, by the maximum frequency value. We have this ratio for the green species also. We have this ratio, and for the seventh species, the blue arrow, we have this ratio. So we get this sum of these ratios, and if we divide this sum with the species richness of this area, which is 3, we get this index. In order to make this index comparable with the diversity index, we have to relativize it. So we have to divide the index of each area by the maximum index of rarity, which is 2.5. So in this case, we take these indices, which are actually the rarity indices. And now how the scoring ranking criterion works is just to add the indices of richness and rarity. So we get these values, which are the final scores according to the criteria of diversity and rarity. And according to these scores, we have to select the central Chalkidiki area and then the first peninsula, and to reject from the selection the other two areas. And let's put another, a third criterion, which is naturalness. Naturalness is qualitative, a criterion that can be estimated only subjectively. So I estimate the naturalness of these areas, which I know very good. And I give the maximum value for the third peninsula, which is AUTH peninsula. It is not populated, only monks live there. So the nature is almost intact in this peninsula. I put a high score of naturalness also in the central Chalkidiki, which is forested, and local people have traditional uses of land, so gets a high score. But for the first and the second peninsula, I give a very low rank of naturalness, because the first peninsula and the second peninsula has a lot of touristic activities, and the first peninsula get the lowest naturalness value. So if we take the sum of the criteria diversity, rarity, and add to them the naturalness, we get a new index, which represents all the three criteria, diversity, rarity, and naturalness. And according to this index, we select the central Chalkidiki area and the third peninsula. So as we can see from the criteria, we get different rankings about the areas in Chalkidiki according to the criterion that we will use. For instance, these are the results for the diversity criterion. These are the results from for the combination of diversity and rarity. And these are the results for the combination of all the three criteria. So a problem of using criteria is that we most of the times we estimate them in subjective way. So this is a problem. Another problem is that the scoring system, the arithmetic result of the scoring ranking system, is not necessarily representative of the true conservation value of an area. Also, the application of the system according to criteria is not comparable because different networks where we use also different criteria. Another problem is that some of criteria are qualitative and not quantitative, so their estimation is subjective. And the most important criterion is that the use of criteria and the corresponding scoring and ranking system does not assure the conservation of all species. In order to face this problem, let me present what I mean. The use of criterion diversity, for instance, gave the selection of the first and the second peninsula. According to this selection, species 7, which exists only in the central Halkidiki area, is not protected. So, the use of criteria may leave a lot of species outside the conservation networks. In order to solve this problem, that criteria do not assure the conservation of all species, a new concept has been developed. And this concept is the concept of complementarity. The principle of complementarity has been discovered independently at least four times during the 80s. What is this principle? It is the principle according to which we add new areas in the conservation network so as to maximize the number of species included in the network. Biodiversity conservation is based actually in the selection of areas to structure a conservation network. For adding an area by evaluating its complementarity, we don't have to know the complete composition of the area in species. So we have just to determine the additional species or any other biodiversity surrogates that will be conserved after the inclusion of the area in the network. Let me present how the principle of complementarity works. We have also the case of Halkidiki. First, we must start from an area, to select an area, as our purpose is to protect all or the most possible of the species of the area. It is logical to begin by selecting the most rich area in species. And this area is the first peninsula of Halkidiki. Then, according to the rationale of complementarity, we shall calculate the number of new species that each area, except the first peninsula, adds to the conservation network. And these are the addition of each area and species to the already selected first peninsula of Halkidiki. So, according to the principle of complementarity, we must select as the second area the central Halkidiki area. And in this way, we protect six species in the first peninsula and the seven species in the central Halkidiki area. And in this way, we ensure the conservation of all the species in the area under study. Alongside with the development of complementarity, another principle has been developed, which represents a more complete concept in systematic conservation. This is the concept of systematic conservation planning. Systematic conservation planning is actually a rationale and a set of methods aiming at selection of set of areas which will have a complementary role in biodiversity conservation and can fulfill certain and quantitatively determined targets of conservation. It comprises actually a scientific basis for policy development in conservation. It offers solutions and scenarios concerning the selections of different networks and the consequences of these selections in conservation and management. Also, it comprises a basis to monitor the achievements of conservation targets. The main scope of systematic conservation planning is to prioritize candidate areas for conservation purposes in order to establish or to improve conservation networks. Conservation planning, an important characteristic of conservation planning is that it is an iterative procedure of optimization. Actually, it includes six stages of implementation. And the iteration procedure concerns that the repetition of these six stages so as to optimize the result. The reason that we need such an optimization procedure is because actually we don't know what exact measures we have to take in order to conserve all the species. However, we know in general that what is good to be done. We know, for instance, the direction towards which we can move in order to conserve some species. Then, after doing some, applying some measures, we can collect more information, more data, and in this way we can learn by doing. Of course, we do not start from a zero knowledge, but at the beginning we have some knowledge and some data about species, but we don't have a full set of data, or we don't understand everything about the conservation plan problems we have to solve. However, in the course of a systematic conservation planning procedure, we gather more data, more explicit data, and through the optimization procedure, we can find the optimal solutions. So, the optimization procedure, which is the main characteristic of systematic conservation, actually aims at finding the optimal solutions. I must say that such optimization procedures let's see now the six stages of biodiversity systematic conservation planning. The first stage includes the measure and map of biodiversity. It is very important to have the best possible data sets of biodiversity in order to apply systematic conservation planning. On the basis of a data set of a good quality, we can expect to obtain effective conservation measures. By using, on the other hand, by using scanning or erroneous data, it is very possible to obtain, to make errors and not to achieve our target. So we must decide firstly which surrogates we will use in order to plan the conservation. We have to take a decision on taking into consideration the possible limitations that we have because of the lack of data about certain surrogates. Then on the basis of the existing data, we must plan a new data collection. So in this way, we can obtain new or to complement existing data sets on biodiversity surrogates. We must also consider, however, the time and the budget we have available in order to complete such a task. In any case, it deserves all the possible efforts in order to improve the data we have on biodiversity surrogates, because the quality and the soundness of every decision we will take during the process of smart conservation planning is very much based on the quality and the quantity of this data. For instance, if we have some data that shows that a species is present in an area, but the species the last years have been extinct in this area, then applying the systematic conservation planning, we may choose this area in order to protect the species. But when we will go to apply conservation measures, we will discover that the species is not there, it is extinct. So we must choose another area, and by all these errors, we will lose time, sources, without any reason. Finally, in this stage, in the first stage, we must collect also additional information about the surrogates, such as their abundance, their habitat quality. We must also collect data on environmental parameters and data, for instance, on the pressures and threats that exist for biodiversity surrogates in the area. So this first stage is very basic and very crucial, and it concerns the collection of biodiversity data. I must say here that in order to complement the existing biodiversity surrogate data, we can also use modeling techniques so as to predict the distribution of some species or habitat types in the area on the basis of the existing results. In this way, we will increase the density of the data in the area, and this is a very often applied approach in order to acquire more data in a very quick time and costless way. The second stage of systematic conservation planning concerns the identification of conservation goals for the planning region. These goals must be specific in terms of quantity and quality. So we must decide how many individuals we aim to conserve for each species, how big is the area we aim to conserve for each habitat type, and other similar things. I should stress out that we need specific quantitative targets in this stage. We must also set some goals that concern the characteristics of the conservation network. We shall decide on the minimum area of the protected areas, their connectivity that they shall have, the distribution of protected areas in the geographical space, the shape of these areas, and other similar things. Finally, we must also set some qualitative targets for the biodiversity surrogates. For example, as far as possible, new conservation areas that would be selected must have minimal disturbances from human in the past. The task of this stage is, in this stage, the second stage of smart conservation planning, is actually very, very difficult. Many times we have not the data or the knowledge or even the methods in order to decide on certain quantitative targets for some surrogates. For instance, it's difficult to decide which is the minimum size of a species population that ensure its conservation and persistence in an area. To do such a thing, we need a special analysis, such as the population viability analysis, but results for such analysis from such analysis are very scanty and concern very few species. And in order to comprise new analysis, new viability, population viability analysis, we need a lot of data and a lot of time in order to collect this data and run the analysis. Another example is that in the case of vegetation types, of habitat types, for instance, is even more difficult to decide what shall be the target, the minimum area of this habitat type in order to conserve this habitat type in the wider area. Actually, there are not scientific methods in order to calculate the minimum viable, in a way, area of a habitat type. However, although many cases, there is a very high degree of uncertainty in the decision of conservation targets, it is very much necessary to complete this task on the basis of the best available information. For this reason, we can apply and use principles and theories that exist in biogeography, in metapopulation dynamics, in species ecology, species evolution. You can use any available scientific information in order to take decisions on the conservation targets, although albeit under high uncertainty. In the third stage of systematic conservation planning, we have to review the existing reserves. Almost in all the areas of the world, there are some already protected area, so we must take in consideration the existing reserves in an area. Actually, we must check how many and what proportion of the existing network protect from the surrogates, from the biodiversity surrogate we choose to apply in the first stage of systematic conservation planning. Then, on the basis of these evaluations, we shall identify the gaps that occur in the already existing network regarding the targets we have set in the second stage of systematic conservation planning. So, in any way, in every possible way, we must fill these gaps. Actually, we must select new areas in order to achieve the conservation targets we set in the second stage. Finally, in this stage, in the third stage, we must review the geometric characteristics of the existing conservation network. For instance, we must check the size of the protected, already protected areas, their connectivity, and other similar factors. In the fourth stage of smart conservation planning, and after the review of the existing reserves, we need to select additional areas in order to achieve our conservation targets. The existing reserves, the already existing reserves, should be recognized as spatial constraints around which we will enlarge the reserves and we will add new areas for conservation. Actually, it is something that is suggested in every similar situation is to retain all the already existing reserves, because we need a lot of effort in order to make a reserve. We need a lot of legislation, so it is not advisable to delete an already existing reserve. Then we must make different scenarios of new areas that can be added in the already existing network. In order to make this, we shall take into account any limitation that may exist concerning the selection procedure. For instance, we must avoid areas that are dedicated for other land uses, and it is impossible to devote these areas for conservation purposes. So we must take all the in consideration all the possible constraints we have in the selection of new areas. As there are many factors and parameters that we shall take into account, and many alternatives of new areas that can be selected to be added in the conservation network, we cannot make this selection by using our similar of our logic. For this reason, we must use special algorithm, a special software, in order to make these selections. This software will give different scenarios, and they able to use, capable to use different factors in order to make the selection of new areas. All these selection algorithms and software are based on the principle of complementarity we saw before. Now, in the fifth stage of systematic conservation planning, and after the selection of new areas and the establishment of an improved conservation network, it's time to take action by applying conservation measures. I mean that we must decide on specific conservation measures that we shall apply in order to improve the conservation status of species or habitat types. First, we must consider what is feasible to be done concerning management, and to avoid to identify and manage areas that we cannot dedicate for conservation. In some cases, the management or the conservation of some areas may be proved infeasible. So these areas should be changed. So we will go to formal steps, formal stages of systematic conservation areas, and to select alternatives, appropriate alternatives. Third, we must decide on the timing and the exact plan of the application of conservation measures. And we must take also into consideration the available resources in order to apply these conservation measures. One strategy for scheduling conservation action within a region is to plot the areas or the biodiversity surrogates in a system of two axes, in which the horizontal axis will represent the vulnerability of the areas of the or of the biodiversity surrogates, and the other, the vertical axis, will represent the irrepressibility of these areas or biodiversity surrogates. Now, areas or biodiversity surrogates that have high value concerning vulnerability and irrepressibility receive the highest priority for conservation action. These areas are most likely to be lost, and because of the absence of small numbers of replacements, their loss will have most serious impact on the achievement of targets. In these cases, these areas which have high vulnerability and irrepressibility are shown in this quadrant of the graph, in the first quadrant of the graph. Then the second priority will be the areas which are, or the biodiversity surrogates which are vulnerable, but not irreplaceable. These surrogates, for instance, as they face specific threats, we must take action in order to save them from these threats. So it will be the second priority in conservation action. The third priority in conservation action will be the areas or the biodiversity surrogates which are irreplaceable but not vulnerable. Actually, these surrogates do not face immediate threats, but they are rare in the area, and they are irreplaceable. So they are threatened from stochastic events that may vanish them. So the third priority will be the biodiversity surrogates with low vulnerability but with high irrepressibility. Then the fourth and the final priority will be given to the species that are neither vulnerable or nor irrepressible. These species, biodiversity surrogates, not face threats, and they are common in geographical space. So only if we have the sources, we can deal with the management of these species. Actually, in most cases, no certain management measures are needed for these species that are not vulnerable and are not irrepressible. Finally, the sixth and the final stage of systematic conservation planning, we must decide on specialized management actions for each protected area, and also to schedule an appropriate monitoring scheme. Actually, sound management should include the implementation of all the five former stages, but this time for each protected area separately. It should include a detailed evaluation of biodiversity surrogate conservation status, and the set of certain target for each protected area separately. This process actually is not fixed and unidirectional. New data on patterns and processes from each area might lead us to adjustments and adaptations according to the previous plans. Finally, it is very important in this sixth stage of smart conservation planning to establish and implement an appropriate monitoring system. The periodic monitoring in order to assess the effectiveness of management actions in achieving conservation targets with subsequent adjustment of these targets and activities is a key factor for a successful conservation of biodiversity. Adaptive management based on the results of monitoring is crucial not only to ensure effectiveness of conservation implementation for biodiversity elements, but also in order to assess the adequacy of resources for management, the capability of the responsible institutions, and the accountability with which funds are being used. Although systematic conservation planning was originally intended as a tool for reserve selection, it evolved through time in a certain field of conservation biology, which aims at the effective allocation of conservation efforts, the implementation of conservation actions, and the efficient use of conservation resources. It is actually a framework for practitioners with a list of well-done, defined, systematic steps and decision support tools necessary to conduct conservation planning and management, so as all this procedure to be transparent, accountable, flexible, and cost-effective. However, I must say that smart conservation planning has also some certain limitations, and it suffers from a lot of uncertainty during its implementation. One limitation we have is that we must take into account the preconditions of the involvement of management bodies and stakeholders in all the procedure. It is very possible that we will plan a very good system, but without involving the management bodies and the stakeholders, it is very possible also to not to succeed the implementation of this conservation plan. Another problem is to understand what is feasible about the targets and what are the limitations about their achievement. Setting unreasonable targets and without taking into consideration the importance and nature of existing limitations can also lead to expense in time and resources. Finally, as I said before, systematic conservation planning suffers from a lot of uncertainties. These uncertainties concern the choice of biodiversity surrogates. I must say here that there is not a true surrogate of biodiversity. For instance, if we choose butterflies in order to conserve plants, we will not succeed in the conservation of all plants. We know this fact nowadays. So it is advisable to use as much as possible surrogates we can. So there's not a gold surrogate, but there is a very effective combinations of different surrogates that we can use. Another source of uncertainty is conservation targets. As I said before, actually many times we don't have the knowledge, the information in order to set with certainty the conservation targets for the species, for the habitat types. So we must make decisions under uncertainty and then correcting this decision in the through the iterations of systematic conservation planning. Another source of uncertainty is the decision of management practices. Many times we don't know the best or the optimal practice in order to increase the population size of a species. So also in these cases we have a lot of uncertainty. Another Another source of uncertainty we have is the conflicts with other land uses. We may select some areas in order to dedicate them for conservation purposes, but later on, maybe some human activity will make this area very expensive, and there will be a lot of pressures in order to change the land use of this area and to move it from conservation to exploitation. Another uncertainty concerns the availability of sources. We all know from our countries that there are not permanent sources for dedicated for conservation. So many times we do not know if money will be given for the next years for conservation purposes. And finally, source of uncertainty concerns the management outside the conservation network. For instance, we must set a good system in order to detect fires inside the conservation areas, but we may have a fire outside from the conservation network that will affect tragically also the conservation areas. However, the rationale of smart conservation planning is that progressively through each iterations, the degree of uncertainty will be reduced. By collecting new data, by collecting more detailed data, by accumulating experience and knowledge, in the future, after 10 years, after 15 years, after 20 years, we will succeed in the in a significant reduction of uncertainty. So it is very important to implement smart conservation planning and to follow all the procedures in order to gather the data, the knowledge and experience we must have. Some things that are being advised in order to deal with uncertainty in smart conservation planning is the allocation of more resources, funds and personnel and infrastructure in order to collect good field records of species and other biodiversity futures. As I said before, the first stage is very basic. The first stage of smart conservation planning is very basic because all the other stages are based on the quality and the quantity of data we have available. Another advice is to use in an appropriate way statistical or robust statistical techniques in order to predict the distribution of species on the basis of the already existing data. In this way, we can make the records we have much more dense in the area under conservation. We can use this more data in order to make decisions. However, also in this case, the quality of the model outputs are very much based on the quality of the initial data set of true species occurrences in the area. And I said before that the selection of new areas for improving the existing networks cannot be done on the basis of just logic. There are many, many factors that we shall take into account. So there are specialized algorithms and softwares. And the two most widely used softwares are Markson and Zonation. These softwares actually take into account many, many factors in order to select new areas on the basis of the complementarity principle. For instance, some very common factors that this software can take into account is the irreplaceability of biodiverse surrogates, the cost of land in order to be chosen or not to be chosen as a protected area, the spatial characteristics of the geometrical characteristics of the selected areas, such as the area connectivity, the size, and the shape of the selected areas, This software can also set different targets per biodiversity surrogate. So we can, for instance, select to protect 100% of all the individuals of a species, but for another species we can select only 10% of its population. And also can give different weight to the biodiversity surrogates. Let's see some examples how these algorithms and software can work. For instance, we have here also again the example of Halkidiki, and we will apply the criterion of complementarity and irrepressibility together. According to the criterion of irrepressibility, we must select the area which protect the unique appearance, occurrence of the species 7. So according to the criterion of irrepressibility, we may choose as the first area the central Halkidiki area. Then applying the criterion of complementarity, we can choose the first peninsula of Halkidiki. We can use the criterion of complementarity together with the criterion of cost. In this case, we have to calculate the cost of land in each area, and I estimated that the cost of land is very low in the third peninsula of Halkidiki, is medium in the central Halkidiki area, it's high in the second peninsula, and very high in the first peninsula. These two peninsulas have a very high cost of land because of touristic development in the area. So in that case, we may choose on the basis of the cost as the first area, the third peninsula of Halkidiki, because this peninsula protect four species, these four species, and has a very low cost. It has a very few pressures for land use change. And then after selecting this low cost area, we can select the area which complements this first area and result in the protection of all species. And this area is the central Halkidiki area. And so in this case, we select we protect all the species and we minimize the cost of the conservation network we establish. Finally, we can set different targets per species and use also the principle of complementarity. For instance, we can say that the target we have for each species are these. So we can see that we want to protect one area, one occurrence for species 1 and the other species, but two occurrences for species 5 and two occurrences of species 6. In this case, species 6 occurs in two areas, and species 5 in three areas. In order to achieve our target, we select first the first peninsula of Halkidiki, which helps in the achievement of the target for a lot of species, in which we want just one occurrence. And then we may select the third peninsula of Halkidiki, and in this way we protect, we fulfill the target for the species 6, or we can select the second peninsula in order to achieve the target for species 5, or even the central Halkidiki area in order to achieve also the target for species 5. So a proposal may be the selection of the first peninsula of Halkidiki and the central Halkidiki area, because in this way we fulfill the target for species 6, the two occurrences. We fulfill the targets for all other species and also for the species 7, which occurs also only in the central Halkidiki area. But in any case, we cannot fulfill the target for species 5, because we protect this species only in one area, in the first Chalkidiki Peninsula and not in another area. And the reason that we cannot fulfill the target for species 5 is that is because we cannot select an additional area. In conservation planning, we must understand we have limitations in the implementation. So in this case, we cannot exceed the percentage of 50% of the selection in the selection of areas. So in many cases, some targets cannot be fulfilled. In such cases, we can take other conservation measures in order to achieve the conservation of the species. Now, systematic conservation planning can must face also some challenges in the future. Well, a major challenge in systematic conservation planning is the climate change. According to climate change, we expect that the distribution of a lot of species will be changed in the future. Actually, the conservation networks we have now have been scheduled, have been planned according to the nowadays, the present distribution of the species. So if in the near future we will have a change in the distribution of the species, it is very much clear that some areas will fail to conserve the species for which they have been designated for. One positive fact about climate change is that we have already understand what is happening, that we must adapt the systematic conservation planning and the conservation networks. However, there are some also negative facts. The first fact is that actually we don't know exactly how the conservation, the climate change will change the conservation of target species, the distribution of the target species, as well as the processes, the ecological processes and the ecosystem in general. Another problem that we must face is that it is very difficult, even if we will understood exactly how all these biodiversity surrogates will be affected, it's very difficult to implement all the changes that will be needed in order to conserve the species, the biodiversity surrogates in the new distribution. And the third problem is that we need a very high amount of sources and money in order to make all these changes in the conservation networks, in order to face the effects of climate change. In any way, however, it is very much understandable that the ongoing changes to species and ecosystems needs require re-evaluation of conservation targets and re-estimation of conservation networks. Some examples of how we must act in the face of climate change in order to adapt smart conservation planning is given here in this slide. One way to face these changes is to calculate new species distribution according to climate change scenarios. For instance, to calculate the distribution of the species after 50 years, after 100 years. Another important thing is to estimate the areas that maybe have refugial properties. Some areas in climate change of the past have served as refugia for a lot of species, and it is expected that also some areas will play a similar role in the climate change, in the human-induced climate change. So we must find these areas and we must understand how they will work in the future. Another important thing is to focus our conservation efforts on making corridors across latitudinal and elevation gradients in order to facilitate the moving of the species in response to the new climate conditions. And to incorporate in the present conservation networks, also the areas that will become increasingly important for future biodiversity. In conclusion, we have to calculate movable reserves. So we have to take into consideration that the present networks has to move in the future to change their geographical space. And it is very difficult, I must say that it's very difficult also to understand which will be the human response to climate change, because also humans will change some things in response to climate change. For instance, they will choose different agricultural areas. And we don't know, we cannot predict easily the impacts of this change of human response to biodiversity. So, in summary, the challenges that the systematic conservation planning must face in the future is the high rate of ecosystem change and the persistence of biodiversity in the already protected areas. Also, to deal with the complexity of interacting factors that makes predictions to the change of biodiversity highly uncertain. Another problem concerning systematic conservation planning is that we have to move from an academic planning to effective implementation. In many countries, and Greece is included in these countries, systematic conservation planning took place just as research or as an academic exercise. And on the ground and on the true conservation policy has never been implemented. So we have to move and make smart conservation planning a tool in conservation policy and implementation. For many species, we must improve our knowledge on their distribution or their ecology, as well as in the interaction they have with other organisms, especially concerning the changing of climate in the future. And another problem and challenge that systematic conservation planning must face is that conservation planning has to be, and it is, a flexible procedure, but its implementation through governance processes and legislation in most cases is not flexible. What I mean here is that we need, among the conservation measures, we need also some legal conservation measures. So we need new legislation that will protect some species or habitats. It is it has been proven very difficult in order to adapt this legislation, the laws, to the added knowledge in science. And finally, another problem that has been recorded recently is that there is a lack of adequate evaluation of the positive impacts of systematic conservation planning in conservation outputs. So we must give a lot of efforts in order to prove and quantify the conservation outputs of systematic conservation planning. In any case, smart conservation planning is unquestionably a useful, the most useful and a very important advance in conservation decision making, and is the way that we must move in order to apply conservation policy. And the final slides, slide I have concerns the state of the art concerning conservation systematic planning in Europe. As I said before, in many countries, in some countries, I'm not sure, systematic conservation planning has been conducted only as an academic exercise. It has not implemented in everyday conservation management and policy. However, all the European countries have a very important tool, that is the Habitat Directive, which is very much compatible to the systematic conservation planning. Actually, Habitat Directive have the same principles with systematic conservation planning, but also it has some certain differences. Let's see first the similarities with systematic conservation planning. For instance, the Habitat Directive is based on the habitat types, including the Annex 1, and the species, plant or animal species, including Annex 2. Actually, the habitat types and the species included in the first two annexes of the directive comprise the biodiversity surrogates that are used also in systematic conservation planning. The parameters used in the directive to assess the conservation status of habitat types and species, and these parameters concern the range and the area of species or habitat types, the size of population of species, the structure and function of habitat types, and the future perspectives for species and habitat types, comprise the means for the quantification of biodiversity, as is done in systematic conservation planning. Habitat Directive actually asks to set reference values for the species and the habitat types, and specifically for the population of the species, for the area of habitat types. In many countries, I heard that it is very much silly to define this reference value. It is not possible, for instance, to determine how big must be a population for a species in order to succeed its conservation, or how much must be the area of a habitat type in order to achieve its conservation. However, according to the systematic conservation planning rationale, it is very much necessary calculate and to determine these reference values, because actually these values represent the conservation targets. And as we said before, in the second stage of smart conservation planning, it's absolutely necessary to define certain quantitative targets for each biodiversity surrogate. And as the biodiversity surrogates in habitat directives are the habitat types and the species, for each of them, we must determine certain reference values. Also, the Habitat Directive set up also the monitoring scheme of conservation implementation. Every 6 years, each member state shall give a report about the conservation status of the habitat types and the species, and to report also the effectiveness of all the conservation measures that have been taken. So, also according to Habitat Directive, this is a similarity with the systematic conservation planning process. On the other hand, there is a great difference with systematic conservation planning. The Natura 2000 network has been defined in the frame of Habitat Directive according to the distribution of the surrogates that the directive uses, and these surrogates are the habitat types and the species in the two first annexes. However, in most of the cases, the calculation, the determination of this network has been made intuitively and not according to certain algorithms and to certain factors. In many countries, it has been proved in research that although the Natura 2000 network is a very big network in each country, it fails to protect main biodiversity elements in each country. So we need here a recalculation of the effectiveness of Natura 2000 network, and we need here an improvement on Natura 2000 network. Another disadvantage is that the Habitat Directive is not flexible. It is a law, a directive that every member state shall follow. It does not accept frequent changes and big changes, but unfortunately, according to the new knowledge we have and the new experience, a lot of changes must be done. Furthermore, many countries, and Greece is included in these countries, didn't offer in the Habitat Directive the best biodiversity characteristics of the country. So a lot of species in Greece must be added in the Habitat Directive in order to help the directive to conserve the biodiversity of Greece. But all these changes are not easy to be done according to the legislation status of the Habitat Directive. And with this slide, I would like to thank you, all of you, for attending. I see that we have up to now